Hi, Emalie.
Hi, Charlotte.
So here I am now. This is take two.
Because yes, it is.
The last time. I didn't forget, but the computer didn't record it.
Such a shame. It was such a good podcast, but we will make it better.
It's going to be much better this time. Now we have a small rehearsing.
Exactly.
Yes. So what are we going to talk about?
So today we're going to talk about the Red Book Project.
Yes.
And about collaborating across borders and about the colleagueship that you and I have have started after participating in the project together. And we'll talk about some of the models in the book and also where you can buy the book.
Yes.
Yes.
Because that is very important. We want to sell some of these books.
Yes.
Not for our sake, because we have got our money. We have been paid. We are not going to get paid again. But because we want to save some animals.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yes.
So.
It's very good.
Yeah. I was thinking about the other day after we have hung up, because we were talking a week ago. And then we had to fiddle with some time management to get it to work again. Because life is
heavy. And exactly.
It's not as, what do you call it? You're going to school and I'm working. And school is work as well. Would you tell us a little bit about what your school is about?
Yes. So as some of you very awake people on Instagram might have noticed, I wasn't there at Feanor, and I am working on this project remotely from Glasgow in Scotland. I study textile design at the Glasgow School of Art, where I specialize in knitting, in particular machine knitting. Mm-hmm. But I also have 10 years of hand knitting experience, and I've known Lisa for a long time, which is how I got involved in this fabulous project.
Yes. So at your school, because you were talking about that the last time, at your school, they don't consider hand knitting to be something that you can live from afterwards.
No, or at least that is not a focus of the school.
Yeah.
And I've been thinking a lot about that since, but I think it's because so many people don't have hand knitting skills anymore. Yeah. So they have a difficulty teaching them to reach a good enough level. Whereas with machine knitting, it's not easy, but it's fairly easy to sort of build up the skills. You have the instructions of how to set the machine, and then everything's pretty much going as it should. Whereas in hand knitting, you drop stitches or you do something completely wrong and you don't know why. And yeah.
No, and machine knitting, you can ship out and make a huge, a huge bunch to sell in shops.
Exactly,
and
yes.
Knitting, you're still going by hand, and it is more. And if you're going to get paid by the hour for hand knitting, then hand knitting would be crazy expensive.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But there are some beautiful hand knitting companies out there. There is the Faroese company, Gulrun & Gulrun, and they do hand knitted clothes only. And I think that's very admirable.
Yes.
And yeah, it's fantastic that people still do it for a living, even though it's...
I was on the Faroe Island teaching 2, maybe 3 years ago.
Yeah.
And Stine Holgaard, another Danish knit designer, and I were in Torshavn. We were teaching in a small island called Fuglfjord. But we went to Torshavn afterwards, and we saw a lot of collective knitters when you are knitting up, and then you're selling it from a collective shop. I really loved that idea. And the hand knitting was not expensive, so the knitters were not paid by the hour, you could say. But many, many hand knitters just love having the knitting in their hand. And if they could get paid just a small amount of money, they are very happy. And I know I'm using a knitting ladies who knits for me. And they are not handsomely paid, because then I wouldn't get anything either. And for me, it is a business. So I need to get paid.
Mm.
So yeah,
but we
to the all the money talk about around knitting is very hard, I think.
But it worked very conveniently because now you brought up the test knitters, and we talked about last time we had some fun, well, not fun things to share, but similar to you and me, Charlotte also worked on the Red Book project from far away. She worked from Chilean. So at least for me, the first time I saw my designs were when they were done.
Yeah,
they were already finished. The pattern was finished. And I didn't get to see, I saw one of them before, but other than that, all three of them were done while I was here in Glasgow.
Yeah.
And I experienced a few challenges, but it was also very fun. How was your experience of that, Charlotte?
Oh, yeah. I'm quite used to ship the knitting out, but I always make a test sample in the exact yarn and on the needles that we're going to knit on, and then I ship it out. But this time some of the yarn was very late arriving, and we were making a change in one of the yarns I was using because of the collaboration with the first yarn company didn't work out, so we choose another yarn company. And I haven't knit in the yarn before. I have only touched some sample that Lisa have had knitted for us, because we had knitting sample of all the yarn. And I thought, oh, it was a similar gauge, it was a similar drape, but then it wasn't, because it was only by memory that I was, because I didn't have the samples anymore, so I only had what I have in my memory and on my notes. So I took the yarn and made a swap and didn't knit it myself and sent it out to my knitting lady, and she had to get the gauge, and the drape was not the same. The gauge was the same, but the drape was not the same. And that is one of the challenges when you make a yarn swap, is the drape going to be the same? Normally you have it in your hand so you can get the feel of it. Yeah. But I didn't have it in my hand, so I couldn't get the feel of it. So it was first when I had the finished project here at my table at home, I could see, oh, I would have loved for the drape to be a little bit more drapey, so the gauge to go up a bit. But it was too late, and we haven't had the time to make a new project or a new knitted sample, because time was running out, and Lisa had booked the photographer, and we had a finished deadline, and yeah, it was just to ship it out. But it is only me, because Lisa said, oh, she couldn't see that there was anything wrong. So it was only my own expectation of the project that it had to be different.
But it looks fantastic. I love all of them.
Yeah, you had some fun with some of your designs, I know.
Yes, I did. but one of the things we were talking about last time was my tiny tuna tunic.
Yes.
And one of the fun stories is that my lovely test knitter Ose, I forgot to write that the tiny tunas were knitted in stocking stitch.
Yes.
So she thought it was just knit on both sides.
Yeah, so it was
which produced some very funky looking tiny tunas. but it's a really fun story, and yeah, I love telling it, and sometimes I show the photos too, but yeah. thank you also for knitting, and to all the other test knitters, because it's been such a great help.
But actually it is very important that when you have the knitting ladies, both if it is test knitting or people you have knitting the knitting sample for you, you always have to have a lot of talking back and forth, because it can get wrong, and what you read or what you write can be misunderstood when you're reading it and knitting it. So actually, and I can't find it now in my messy table, I had knitted one of the small tunas the last time, because
oh!
I had a sweater for Laia in some of the scrap yarn from the book,
and yeah.
I'm going to drizzle some tunas around. It's another sweatshirt, but the tunas is going to be there. And I'm knitting them in a lovely blue cotton wool.
Oh, amazing.
Yeah. I don't get gauge. because it is a completely other yarn. But I think when you're just doing the appliques,
exactly, that's a great thing about the tunas and all the applique projects in general in the book, is that they can be knitted from scrap yarn that you already have, so you don't need to go out and buy a new yarn. So even your parrot, I think, yes, would work really well in leftover yarns as well. Yeah. And the iguana would look beautiful. So it's a really great thing to consider how you can use your scrap yarns, because I think you could really get some very nice garments just from scraps.
Yeah, and because the tunas are so small, then the second yarn that I'm joining is a Peruvian Highland wool, and it is quite thick. It's for a knit needle 5, I think, and I'm just going to split it like this.
Clever.
Yeah, because I have this. When you can knit a tuna.
It's very exciting. We were talking about as well that you can use it to repair your clothes.
Yes.
So if you have holes in jumpers or in your jeans, instead of going out and buying a patch in a shop, then you can knit your own tuna. And you can.
Invisible mending is quite in the time right now, I think.
Yes. So I do it on all my things.
Mending and
I'm trying to find my jacket.
I have.
Because I mended, I had a hole in my sleeve. And I fixed it.
Yes, exactly. I have fixed a pair of woolen stocking, what do you call it, strømpebukser.
Yeah.
Yeah. And the toes were working out the first time I wore them, and I thought, oh no, this is a pantyhose for about 200 Danish kroners. I'm not going to throw them out. I'm going to mend them. So
it's very good. I love it.
Knitting and in board clothes. I think it's very nice. The whale, we were talking about the whale the last time, because I have a small online group of people who are knitting and community, and some of them would very much love to knit the tuna, and they're going to try and make it a little bit bigger because the person is tall. And when you are knitting, this is some of the thing that you actually can do yourself with a little bit of math and trying it on, fiddling.
Yes, I would say trying it on is a key thing, but the tuna in particular is quite easy to adjust a bit yourself if you already have some knitting knowledge.
Yes.
Because it's knitted in panels. Yeah. So you can change each panel depending on your size. So for example, the orange panel that goes along here, you can extend that, make it a little bit bigger, because then you get a bit of extra width around the waist, but you also get a bit longer sleeves if you're a bit taller.
Yeah.
So it's a fairly, it's not, I wouldn't say it's a fairly simple thing to do, but it's manageable. And if you write to me on Instagram, I'll happily help out as well.
Yes, because
I'm sure Charlotte will put my name in the comments.
I will. I'm making a description down below this video, and I'm going to tag you, and I'm going to tag where you can buy the book, and a lot of things I'm going to write down there, I think.
Yes, it's fantastic.
Yes. The design, the tuna, I'm going to get back to that, because I remember when we were talking one of the first times when your inspiration, because your inspiration for that, exactly, the adult tuna sweater, it was very bizarre, I thought.
Yeah.
But also very, very clever.
I think that is the art school background that plays in a little bit, but before starting this project, we were presented with all the animals that we wanted to have in the book, and then we were asked to choose two animals. So for me, I chose the bluefin tuna and the blue whale because I have a very strong relationship with the sea. And I went on a large trip called Semester at Sea as a scholarship student, and I basically went to Japan, which is where I had my first sort of experienced with the high prices of tunas at the Japanese fish markets. And I remember seeing in this like large hall that you just have the tunas laying out, just in like strip by strip by strip, and they're all cut up, and you can see sort of the fleshy colors next to sort of the vibrant Japanese signs. And that's how I came up with the color palette of the tuna. And the shape itself is the shape of half a tuna. Cut it in half and put it upside down. So it's almost like the tail is pointing down. And similarly to the rib structures and the pattern here is that it reminds me of the fins and the way they sort of spread out as well. So it was a really fun thing to try and figure out, but it took a lot of math and a lot of thinking and how will I do this?
It is, as a, some designs, I think it's very trial and error. You have to try and then you completely miss. And then you have to try again and make small paper samples and small cloth samples to see if the construction is going to work, and then you have to figure out how am I going to knit this. I have a lot of small paper constructions, and then I'm going to scale them up, and then afterwards I'm applying the knitting. And it's because, like you, I have a sewing background. I'm a craft and Hornarbeit teacher, and I have made my bachelor in textile and teaching. So for my first, for the very first time that I was going to make a design, I made a whole piece of cloth when I sew it up, and then I was applying the knitting afterwards. And with the difficult shapes, I still do that. Do you
want That's a good piece of advice.
Yeah.
I actually started hand knitting before I went to art school, and I started designing hand knits before I went to art school. I went to actually a construction course at the Lisa at the Kashmir company many years ago, where she showed a few of us how to sort of calculate gauge, how to write out a pattern, sort of what you needed to take into consideration. And that is, I guess, 4 or 5 years ago now. So before I started my current course, and that's also where when I started to think about designing my own things.
I did something similar here at the in Copenhagen at the Hornarbeitets Fremme is the name, and a knitwear designer and teacher Louise Klint had the course, and I took several months of hand knitting there just to get the craft. I've been knitting since I was 5, but just to get some more knowledge. And I still do a lot of courses online with Patty Lyons, and she's very clever and very, very smart in her teaching. She's on Craftsy was the old name. I think it's Blueprint now. And Shirley Payton. A lot of people talking about construction and knitting construction. I love to take that kind of courses.
Oh, fantastic. But you love teaching as well. How did you sort of get more into teaching than designing?
Yeah, I am a teacher. I've been teaching for many years, and I quit my job doing the Danish locker out of all the teachers. I was designing on the side. I only worked part-time, and was writing books and designing and teaching part-time. And now I transitioned into first designing and teaching on the side. And now I have switched around, and I'm teaching more than I'm designing, because I think the market right now have a lot of designers. Mm. And my designs are often colorful and not for the masses. So to know how to earn enough money to make a living from it, I had to make a change. And I think I thought to myself, what about online teaching? Because I enjoy online teaching myself, both in knitting and other things. And then I thought, I'm going to give it a try. And it's the best thing I have done for my company for a long time and for myself, because I love teaching. I really love teaching.
Yeah. I love following your Instagram as well with all the little advice and everything. It's amazing. I'll have to sign up sometime and get to know a little more.
Yeah. For now, I'm doing most in Danish, but I am going to transition some of it into English, like now when we are talking.
Yeah.
I'm going to make some tutorials in English as well, because I do one a week in Danish.
Yeah. But Charlotte, do you have any advice to the Danish knitters who might want to knit some of the red models, but they're not as confident in English?
Oh, yeah. The pattern is very well written. And I think if you have a translation key, and there's a lot of translation keys out there, and there's a lot of workshops going around in Denmark. I know for sure, I'm sure that the Danish teacher, Madam Munk, is teaching how to read English pattern. But also the website, Popinden, on the needles.
Yeah.
I think a lot of blog posts about how to read and write English patterns, and yeah, give it a try. If you're not in if you're not reading English at all, I don't think it is for you. But if you know a little bit of English, not much, just a little bit, and then you have a translation key and you can get there anywhere on the web, just search the name on the web and then you find it. It's very easy. And English patterns is more do this, then you do this, then you do this. Where Danish patterns are more like do this, and at the same time you have to do this, this, and this. Yeah. And by the way, you have to do all of this like you did it in the beginning of the pattern. So Danish patterns are more hard to read and understand, because a lot is given, and we have a long knitting tradition. So our patterns is, most of the Danish patterns is for knitters who have been knitting for a long time.
And also in the book, there is also the key of how difficult it is.
Yes.
So maybe an advice would be as well to look at some of the easier models with a lower degree of difficulty to start out with in English.
Yes. I don't think if you're... Even if you are a very good knitter, but you're not as good in reading English patterns, then you should not start with a double knitted cardigan, perhaps. Then you have to start with something simple. Mm. And then work your way around it, because it is quite a heavy book, and there's over 30 patterns in it for both women, men, and kids. Mm. And the sizing is from about 1 year to a size large.
I think so.
Is the biggest size.
I think there are a few extra large, but
yeah,
they're in there.
They are in there, but yeah, it is not the triple X or something. Yeah. Just X large. Yeah,
but about the English and the Danish, there was something about a Danish translation possibly being made as well. You know a bit more about that.
So I just want to make a small video, because I totally misunderstood what Emalie was saying. She was asking about there is going to be a Danish version of the Red Book that you can buy as a PDF, and I was understand something completely different. Now, just give it a look.
Yeah. We were asked to write the pattern is in English, but I didn't get that. So I was writing all of my pattern is in Danish, because I am Danish, and I write my pattern in Danish and get them translated by someone else. And then a few days before we are going to hand in our patterns, Lisa reminded me that she was going to have the pattern in English. And I was reading in my contract, and I was, in English? What do you mean? Do I have to write them in English? So I had to pick out a lot of, I know how to read an English pattern. And in the old days when I made my first pattern, it was in a terrible English, but it was in English. So I had to pull up a lot of books from myself to know how to say shaping an armhole. How do you say that in English? And knitting short rows and all the small things. How to knit the what you in Danish call a gobelingstrik. In English, it is intarsia. How do you get the right term to make the little loop in the yarn? How do you say that? So it was some work. And then Lisa said, Chrissy Day is going to make the proofreading. And I was just, whew, proofreading in English by Chrissy Day. That is perfect because she is English and very, very, a very able knitter. So I was, that's okay then.
That's very good. But you also usually work on your projects alone. How was it being in a team of people working on this book together?
It was very nice because it can be very lonely to write patterns, because I write patterns for other companies, but I don't work with other people as much. Mm-hmm. So being a lot of people, having Zoom meetings and meeting in real life, it was very nice. And just to have someone to talk to about, what do you do? I want to make this, but I'm not sure about that. What do you think? And then get a lot of input. It makes the designs grow a lot more into something that wasn't expected from the beginning, I think. And it's nice to get to know people and have colleagues, I think.
Yeah, I think in that way it worked really well between you and Bruno, and how you usually do your gobelingstrik, and then the beautiful beetle that he made in his own interpretation.
Yeah,
I thought that was beautiful because you at home won't know this, but we had a group where we could share ideas, and Charlotte then suggested or helped out with getting this beautiful gobelingstrik. A beetle or a tarsia beetle that's on the front of the jumper, and it was beautiful to see how people came together and shared all their knowledge. It was amazing.
Bruno is a textile designer and very very good with that, and he know how to knit, but he don't know a lot of different techniques, but he knows design, and he knew what he wanted, and he wanted this pixelated beagle that was scaled up.
Yeah.
But he was just, how am I going to knit this? Is this going to be double knitting? And he come up with a lot of ideas, and I was just right away, you have to do intarsia for this. This was going to be very nice. And the graphical intarsia is the just garter stitch. So it's very easy.
It's very nice.
Yeah, not like this. I'm knitting lace today, and that is not easy.
No. I remember you telling me you have to look down.
You have to look at what you're knitting all the time.
I have actually never knitted lace patterns before. I usually prefer just Fair Isle patterns.
Yeah.
That is my favorite thing to knit. Mm-hmm. And also a bit of a brioche now.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I have the Fair Isle and intarsia. That is my favorite knittings. But after I have become a mother, I mostly just do stockinette stitch or garter stitch, because I don't have a lot of knitting time, so I just wanted to make it has to go fast. And I don't have to think too much. So this is my first thinking project.
That's very good.
Yeah.
But I don't have kids, so I don't know. But how do you knit for kids that keep growing? Like, is there an advice for how you can?
Yes,
we have so many knitting patterns for kids. But yeah. I'm thinking, I don't have kids, but they grow fast.
They grow so very how? Fast. Laia, she grew two sizes over the summer.
Wow.
So mostly I do something that is not too difficult to knit, so I can knit it fast. And I always make a size or two bigger than she is now. And I can show it here because I am knitting on something for her. This is the leftover.
Oh.
So often I make it so I can cut off the sleeves and elongate it, and cut off the bottom to elongate if I want to do that. Because the first year, when she was one, I knitted her a cardigan, and she wore it for 2 months, then it didn't fit anymore. And it was a cardigan that I could have elongated, but I didn't buy enough yarn. So what I do now is that I buy 2 or 3 balls of yarn extra, then I just store away, because I can use it to make a hat or some mitten if I'm not going to do that. But
Tiny tunas.
Yes, tiny tunas, exactly. But I have to have enough yarn so I can do so I can make it longer later on. Because she's going to wear this now, and I know when she's going to wear it in the springtime, it won't fit anymore. Then I have to make it longer.
But that is very good advice.
Yes, I think so too.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And we also talked about how you can reuse the applique in one of our Zoom meetings.
Yes.
So how if the jumper doesn't fit anymore, but you want to keep the tunas, or if you want to keep the parrot, you can take it back off and then you can put it on something else.
Exactly. And I think that is very, I have the parrot pocket in a tunic, and I'm going to knit it for Laia, and I'm going to make the tunic a little bit longer, because then later on it is just a waist. Because children doesn't grow as much in width than they do in length. So, and in the book, the child who is wearing it is also a little bit bigger or taller than the size that I have knitted for. But so it's more a waist for her than it is a tunic. But yeah.
But that is good to see for the people sitting at home wanting to knit for their children or their grandchildren.
Yeah, and I think another thing is very important, because the patterns are all written for standard sizing, but no child is standard. Laia is 2 now, but she's wearing size 3. She's very tall and slender. I don't know from where she got that. I'm very low and not so slender. And my husband is not tall at all. So take the measurement of the child, and perhaps you have to make it longer, perhaps you have to make it smaller, perhaps you have to make it bigger. To knit a size 4 for a size 3, it's very normal.
And so it's the same for the adult sizes as well.
Yes.
So remember to to check your measurements before you start, because if you start knitting and then you think you're a size small, but then you're really an extra small, then your garment is going to be too big, or the other way around. So it's really important.
The gauge. I'm going to say it again, do the gauge. Because that is one of the biggest troubleshooting problems. I know, because in my online group for knitters, that is the thing that is going wrong again and again and again. It is not to check the gauge and not to do a proper gauge swap. They are knitting small samples. Oh, you have to cast on. Oh, I'm just making it 5 by 5 centimeters, and that is that is not enough.
But I know you have your online course in getting the gauge right as well.
I do. I have an online course for only 50 kroners to how to get gauge and what to do if you don't get gauge.
So a good piece of advice for everyone out there.
Yes, it is. Yeah, because mostly if you knit ferrite, you know that as well, or stranded knitting, you are knitting and you got the gauge in the stitches, but you don't get the gauge in rows. What do you do? So
I'm one of those bad people who don't check the gauge in the height. Well, I started to when I started designing, but before that, I...
when you design, you're the one making the decision.
Exactly, I know. But even then, it was really interesting to see how people have different gauges. So I would send off the gauge to my test knitters, and they would say, oh, I can't get this gauge. How did you do that?
Yes.
Well, and it's Yeah, exactly. It's the same. It's just,
but I'm a normal knitter. I always get the gauge.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, but I had a course of 20 knitters, and they were all given the same knitting needles and the same yarn. And they were all going to cast on 10 stitches and to knit 10 rows. And none of the 20 small swaps were the same size. None of them. So 20 knitters in a room have 20 different gauge, and it's very normal if you are on the same needles. Some had to go a little bit up in needles, and some have to get a little bit down. And some had to get a lot up and a lot down. It's very different. So, and
I did very tightly, so I always need to change as well.
Yeah. I'm a loose knitter. So,
but that's very good for your back and for your, yes. Because being a tight knitter isn't that good.
It's because
your fingers start hurting.
But actually, something that is also important for the gauge is the weather. I have a looser gauge in the winter than I do in the summer, and it is because of all the moist in the air. So perhaps you have a tighter gauge in Glasgow than you get in Denmark.
And very interesting.
I didn't know that, and I was making a design for a Danish magazine called Creative Knitting, and I was doing a lovely Fair Isle cardigan, and it was size small, so I couldn't try it on myself, so I didn't notice that the one sleeve was a little bit, not much, but it was a little bit tighter than the other. Actually, it was a centimeter and a half, but you don't see it. And I knitted the one sleeve in very good weather, and the other sleeve, when I think back, I knitted it. It was just raining. It was pouring down all week, and the weather was very moist. And the lady at the magazine asked me if I was knitting on different needles, and I was, no, I have used the same needles all the way. Yeah. And I knew I had, because I always do that, because I know changing needles for tree to metal or tree to carbon, it could make a huge mess. So I didn't swap the needles, but the gauge was not the same.
Wow.
So, yeah. I always check if I have some hibernating knitting,
yeah.
And I'm picking it back up. I always checking. Oh, I put in a lifeline and knit a few rows, and then I see, do I have the same? And if not, I have to change needle. So, lifelines is also important.
Yeah, it is. That's the beauty of being a knitter.
Exactly. And then you just have to rip out, and then you have more joy of the yarn.
Exactly. Yes, and it's cheaper. That's what my mom always says, that the more you have to undo your knitting, the cheaper it gets.
Exactly. Yeah. And then, for me, it's most about the knitting process. It's not so much of getting it done, because when it's done, most of my knitting is just laying around with all the ends and here, and then it lays for a month or two before I get further onto it, because I just love the knitting.
Yeah.
Don't get me wrong, I loved weaving in ends, and I love seaming it up, but when it's finished, it's finished, and then it have to leave my hands, and I don't want it to leave. I want to keep knitting.
But Charlotte, why don't you just strengehefte while you're knitting?
Oh, I do that most of the times, but not always. In this one, I have weaved in and knit at the same time at the pink one, but I haven't weaved in and knitted at the same time at the light one, because I'm going to see it through, because it's I also have a course on how to weave in ends in a lot of different ways.
That's very good.
Yeah.
All the good skills.
And most of the time I do it while I'm knitting. Then I knit, and then I weave in some ends, and then I knit, or do it at the same time, the strikehefning. But for this one, I have been doing a lot of car knitting, and when I'm knitting in the car, I can't look down. So I can't weave in the ends while driving. I'm not driving, but while sitting in the car, I can't do that. No. Oh, in Denmark, you lose your driving license if you are knitting while driving. So I'm not.
I can imagine. Yes.
Yeah.
Hopefully, it's like that anywhere because you you surely need both.
On YouTube of people
who really? Are
knitting and not knitting and driving, but they, when they are in a light in the in lines and the on the freeway, they are knitting. And oh my god! Yes.
Impressive.
Yes, and dangerous.
Yeah, that too.
Yeah. I think we are going to wrap this up now.
Yeah.
We could have another talk some other day.
Yes.
Yeah, something else from our work together on this book.
Yes. Project. Or if you at home have any questions you want to ask us.
Yes.
Then.
It's possible to. Put your question below, and then I'm going to make collect them, and then we're going to talk about them the next time.
Yeah, because these are just the questions we had for each other.
Yes.
Yeah. So I think that sounds good.
Yeah.
But yes, it's been lovely talking to you, Charlotte, on this podcast.
Yes, I'm happy to talk to you because now we have to make up reasons to talk.
Yeah, exactly.
And Polly is not going to say, hey, we need to have a talk now.
Yeah, exactly.
No, it was
very nice.
The cool spreadsheet with meetings and such. Yeah,
it was very perhaps nice.
If the other, some of the others, I know not all of them, because not all of them is happy to be on camera, but some of them perhaps we can do a larger Zoom
that would be
recording
nice.
Someday. Or perhaps at Christmas we could do a little bit of recording. Meeting up live.
That would be nice.
Yeah, I think so too. So it was very nice to talk to you, Emalie.
It was very nice to talk to you too.
Yes.
And thank you to everyone listening.
Yes,
feels a bit.
Yeah. It's much easier when we are talking. Most
yes, exactly.
I'm just talking with some imaginary friend.
Yeah. Well, I've never talked. Well, last time was my first time doing a podcast or a video interview, I guess.
Yeah.
So for me, this is very new, and I feel very aware that there are other people on the other side who will be watching this and who will see my face. And
yes. And I haven't done my hair this morning. I just. A quick mommy bun because I have I was in a line at home. There was a lot of work on the freeway here, so I've just drove my daughter to Dauphine daycare and drove home again, and then I was just whoa, I'm in a hurry now. But I put on a nice sweater for you.
It looks very nice.
Thank you.
Very nice.
You look nice as well.
Thank you.
So, see you soon, Emalie.
See you soon.
Bye.
Bye.